hear argument first this morning, number 01-1559, Joseph Massaro versus the United States. And Mr. Fahringer.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court.
Wasn't that a very touching and most appropriate flag ceremony? And I am delighted to introduce myself. I'm John Deary, and I have the great pleasure of serving as your Master of Ceremonies here at this wonderful event. The Fahringer family, the Fahringer girls, which of course, Erica, Nicole, and Melissa, and friends all. I could not help but think in the intervening weeks here since the sad news of Harold's passing, how fortunate for all of us gathered here today that somewhere in the course of our lives, our paths crossed and intersected with Harold Fahringer. And it is very hard to imagine that we all don't cherish in many, many different ways the wonderful experience of having that friendship. It's a bit of a trite expression, but I think we would all agree that to use the phrase one in a million is certainly not inappropriate for Harold. Often, after one's passing, the idea of getting together and having a memorial service as we're sharing here today often is thought about right around the time of the burial, but often it does not come to fruition. And let me begin by saying a special word of thanks, I'm sure on behalf of all of us, to Erica for her wonderful coordination and work in making today in this magnificent setting a reality. Thank you so much, Erica, thank you. When we talk about the word after the passing of anyone, the notion is let us celebrate that person's life. And I can't imagine with an extraordinary human being and an extraordinarily life that has been led and an extraordinary series of accomplishments that when you talk about someone's passing and the ability to celebrate the life, very, very few times will we have the opportunity to do it with such celebration and love. I thought that there are a couple of adjectives that would try very briefly to capture Harold, not easy, always elegant, forever gracious, totally sincere, totally caring, a tireless work ethic, a passionate advocate. Some of you may not know, but a part-time magician. And he's someone who saw the big picture and saw every single detail in that big picture. He was a legendary legal giant, and undoubtedly we will hear much about that today. Literally a legendary giant. And I think when you speak about and think about this extraordinary career, 99.99% of us who are lawyers, the closest that we probably come to the United States Supreme Court is taking a bus tour of Washington, D.C. and having it pointed out. But when you think, and we will hear, about the remarkable ability, as we just heard a moment ago, of Harold being called on to appear before the court and to begin his arguments, and to know that he did it time and time again, and was a familiar face at obviously the very highest court in the United States. I couldn't help but notice this program picture of Harold, a remarkably person with a tremendous presence, and can only think that wherever he is when he sees this picture, Cary Grant's going to be eating his heart out, frankly. I think this is some picture of Harold, isn't it? We'll hear many stories. If I may just share an incredibly brief one with you. So myself and a couple of colleagues had the need to get Harold helping us. Of course, we had an administrative hearing in Albany. It was in the summer. It was hot. It was humid. And let me tell you about Harold's day that day. He had numerous court appearances, many of them with Erica. Then he got in a car and he drove up 3 hours to Albany. And we were very nervously, because we had a hearing the next day, we were nervously waiting. And we got the call, summoned by Harold, 11:30 at night, meet me in my room at the Hilton Hotel. We went up to the room. There was a sofa. How were we dressed? Hot and humid. Flip-flops, shorts, T-shirt. And as we sat at the sofa looking at Harold sitting in front of us as he was going to tell us and lecture to us, I was reminded, I think it's the biblical story that says that Christ went to the temple and lectured to the people. This is what we felt. Now, I don't know if Christ went to the temple at 11 at night, but Harold apparently did. I don't know what Christ's garb was that he was wearing, but let me tell you about Harold at 11 until 12:30 that morning. Spiffy shined black shoes, a blue beautifully tailored suit, a crisp white shirt, a wonderful striped tie, and a gold tie bar that almost choked him to death. And that was Harold's attire between 11 p.m. and 12:30 and an hour and a half later. And I might add, and I think just for accuracy's sake, the button in Harold's suit was never undone for the hour and a half. I want you to know that. That button stayed on. And so I just conclude the story by telling you so that it's 12:30 and we're like, geez, maybe we can get a little red or white glass of wine. But we found out that coming to Harold's room at 11 o'clock, we're in the wrong joint for a little wine, see? So, but I do say that Harold did provide, he provided for us. And that was where there was an option of the refreshments for us, two different types of grossly unappetizing protein bars. See, that's what Harold had for us. It wasn't that good. I have the pleasure of this wonderful program of introducing very dear friends, colleagues, and people who we will get to feel and share everything that we probably know to a great extent and hear it reaffirmed. Our first speaker is a very dear personal friend of mine and Harold's. She spent literally hundreds of hours on the phone with Harold. We had many, as may be referred to, dinners with Harold's wonderful stories. For 25 years, Judge McKeon has been in the Bronx Supreme Court. He was the presiding judge of the appellate term. He was the administrative judge of the criminal court in the Supreme Court in the Bronx, and currently is the coordinating judge in the state of New York for all medical malpractice and the administrative judge of the Bronx County Supreme Court. So I'm really, really delighted to introduce Justice Douglas McKeon.
Assemblyman Deary, Erica Dubno, Fahringer family, ladies and gentlemen. There once was an old judge who, by anyone's standards, was considered a great speaker. But despite his vast oratorical skills, he would decline when asked to speak at funerals. And so one fine day, I mustered the courage to ask him about it. "Judge, can I ask you a question?" said I. "Sure. Is there some reason that I've never heard you deliver a eulogy?" "Oh, Doug, there's a very good reason," said he. "You see, I've never been very good at turning an ordinary man in life into a great one in death." Well, my dear ladies and gentlemen, if that old judge was with us today, he wouldn't be confronted with that problem, because Harold Price Fahringer was no ordinary man, and his was no ordinary life. And so today, they have come from all walks of life, near and far, young and old, sharing the experience of a life touched by the splendor of a special man. Come they have to this beautiful and ornate courtroom, a place in which Harold Fahringer would have been most comfortable, a place where, if you close your eyes, you might hear his distinctive voice. You might see his striking presence, the white hair, the blue suit, the tie perfectly knotted against a white shirt, and oh yes, the collar bar. Gold from Tiffany's was his choice, and how mad he was when they stopped making them. And so, my dear ladies and gentlemen, how does one capture the essence of greatness in a few short moments? What words do you use? What memories do you invoke? What accomplishments do you recite? What stories do you tell? There is, of course, the obvious: a man who heard his calling. And it was a voice which beckoned him to greatness. Standing before the United States Supreme Court, not once or twice, nor five or ten, but enough that he knew them, and more importantly, they knew him. "See America," the travel ads once suggested, and see America he did. Not in the passenger seat of a tour bus, or on a plane, or on a train, but in the courtrooms of almost 40 states, in some of the most legendary cases that will grace the pages of law books forevermore. He was, in my mind, and I'm not alone in this assessment, one of the greatest lawyers America will ever know. A testament to hard work, dedication, and loving what one does. But for me, Harold Fahringer was more than accomplishments in a courthouse, or a courtroom, or on a television show, or in a lecture hall. It was the Herald Fahringer who shared with me that he called his mother every day. A son who saw to his mother's comforts until the day she died. It was the Herald Fahringer who remained steadfast and true to a partner who was ill and infirmed, oh, so many years. It must be hard, Harold, Margaret's illness. No, Judge, not at all. Always remember, it's nice to know that there's someone in the next room. It was the Harold Fahringer who had the innate kindness to even think about, let alone give out his holiday envelopes, weeks before anyone else. You know, Judge, these boys look forward to that money. After all, they have Christmas gifts to buy for their own families. And it was Harold Fahringer who, upon leaving church on a Saturday afternoon, was known to put a $100 bill, sometimes three or four, in the small wicker basket held by a nun, raising funds for a worthy cause. I can actually hear him telling me one night that he said of one of the good sisters, "Sister, is that enough?" And it was the Harold Fahringer with whom my dear friend John Deary and I would have our dinners. Photos are there on the side. Because each time we'd ask a waiter to take a picture of the three of us at the restaurant of our choice. And when I've looked at those photos during the years, I couldn't help but to remark to John, we seem to have gotten older. Harold, he just remained the same. Those dinners, Harold enjoyed them, and we enjoyed him. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, today we do say goodbye to one of a kind. Oh yes, what were Shakespeare's words? I shall not look at his like again. I'll miss his voice on the other end of the phone. This man who gave hope to the hopeless, this kind and gracious and thoughtful man, this man who soared as high as eagle's wings and never forgot from whence he came. When President Barack Obama was asked to eulogize his old and dear friend, Senator Edward M. Kennedy, he used these words. And we can strive at all costs to make a better world, so that someday, if we are blessed with the chance to look back on our time here, we can know that we spent it well, that we made a difference, that our fleeting presence had a lasting impact on the lives of other human beings. Ladies and gentlemen, Harold Price Fahringer met that test. He met that standard, and he touched the lives of everyone assembled here today. I am so very grateful and humbled for the opportunity to remember his life with each and every one of you. Thank you for that. God bless you, and God bless Harold Price Fahringer.
Thank you very much, Judge, for those beautiful remarks. It's my pleasure now to introduce one of Harold's nieces. She is the daughter of one of Harold's two sisters, Anne. Anne has passed away, and his other sister, Peggy, I'm sorry, both of whom have passed away. But we have a real live doctor in the house here in Debbie, Dr. Deborah Schiappa. Doctor, come.
I'd like to thank everyone for attending today and especially acknowledge those that have had to travel a great distance. I'd also like to express my condolences to my family and also to Herald's close acquaintances and friends. How does one begin to commemorate the life of someone as incredible as Herald Price Fahringer? Born on November 6, 1927 in Lewisburg, Pennsylvania, he was the oldest child of Herald and Pauline Fahringer, and dear brother to Margaret and Anne. Growing up in the logging town of Williamsport, Pennsylvania, he had a humble upbringing. As a youngster, his father encouraged him to take up boxing at the age of 12. Later, he attended Penn State University, where he studied political science. At one point, all three Fahringer children attended Penn State University at the same time, and intriguingly, Herald was responsible for introducing my father to my mother on campus. After graduating in 1950, he served in the Army in the Korean War and started acting in the USO troop as a temporary replacement. Following his military service, he toured with the traveling theater group of English actor Arthur Treacher. He even worked his way through law school in Buffalo by appearing in television commercials and doing radio broadcasting. No doubt these experiences contributed to his success later in his life and instilled in him ambition and determination and laid the foundation for his distinguishing courtroom stage presence. Following his graduation from the SUNY Buffalo Law School, he became a named partner of the law firm Lipsitz, Green, Skime, Cambria, and Fahringer. He remained based in Buffalo and commuted to Manhattan to argue cases. In the 70s, he opened the Manhattan office of Lipsitz Green. Growing up, my brother David and I knew him as Uncle Buzz, the origin of the nickname, I'm still not sure. He was the bachelor uncle who entertained us as young children with household magic tricks, regaled us with moral-inspiring stories about the Western expert marksman one-shot buck, and spoiled us with gifts of Fannie Mae chocolate Easter eggs. As teenagers, he hosted us on a whirlwind weekend trip to New York City, at which time my brother and I saw Broadway shows, attended a performance of the Radio City Rockettes, enjoyed a bus tour of the New York City sights, and had dinner at the top of the World Trade Center. We also viewed the pre-release before made public production of the first Star Wars movie, all within the course of 2 days' time span. Throughout this time, Herald came to be a prominent criminal defense attorney and gained notoriety as a prime defender of the First Amendment. Noteworthy cases included high-profile clients such as Klaus von Bülow, Larry Flint, Gene Harris, to name a few. He was responsible for winning rights for nude female sunbathers and freedom for death row inmates. He challenged zoning constraints in New York City's Times Square, tried cases in 27 states, and argued 15 cases in the U.S. Supreme Court. He received numerous awards for his excellence in the practice of law and for his contributions to the profession. He taught continuing legal education courses and was a guest speaker at numerous law schools, including Harvard, Cornell, and Fordham. He appeared on national television programs and acted as a legal commentator on CNN. He has also been the subject of numerous feature articles in prominent law journals and national newspapers. Herald, to accomplish all this, was a legendary workaholic, reserving little free time for personal leisure. Work is easy, it's living that's hard, was his motto. His work schedule began in the early morning while others were still sleeping. He once confided to us that he sought to hire office personnel that preferred starting work at 6:30. After finishing his morning briefs, he told us he would finally take a break to eat a bowl of oatmeal and have a break. Later, he would leave his office in the early evening and take dinner at a nearby restaurant that served home cooking, and then return to work later that night to do more work until finally retiring after watching the sports. Only on rare occasions would he take extended personal time off. Once he took a 10-day extended trip to Florence, Italy with his partner, Margaret Noyes. Later he would exclaim to us how he marveled at the artwork, the paintings, the frescoes, the sculptures, and architecture, but also how he couldn't wait to return to work. He also loved the theater, sometimes attending by himself, and one year he sent us a full set of the recordings of all the popular musicals played on Broadway. Harold enjoyed short visits to visit his retired parents that were living on St. Simon's Island, Georgia. Appearances were important to him, especially as his reputation preceded him. He wore custom-tailored navy blue Paul Stewart suits and shirts, Italian leather shoes, and the famed power necktie before it was even defined as such. He abstained from alcohol and cigarettes. He became known as the silver-haired, impeccably groomed, high-priced Fahringer. His appearance and demeanor commanded attention wherever he went. Although our lives would intersect infrequently as he practiced law nonstop, imagine my delight when he attended my wedding ceremony during the hot summer in Chicago of 1984, serving as my surrogate father in place of my deceased dad. Later, as young adults, he would help assist us with the care of my mother that was disabled. In fact, years later, my husband and I would visit him in New York City, at which time he insisted on obtaining last-minute tickets for us to the theater and taking us to Sunday Brunch at Tavern on the Green, both unsolicited gestures. Later in life, Harold left Lipsitz Green to start Fahringer and Dubnow, continuing to practice and defend cases, provide assistance to other attorneys, and teach classes. Harold Fahringer and Erica were both named within the top 100 trial lawyers by the National Trial Lawyers Association. He kept his personal life private. Even when he suffered a heart attack and required open heart surgery, he deliberately shunned attention. Perhaps this is why his recent diagnosis was divulged to so few, in order to protect the integrity of his law practice and shelter his family and acquaintances from the harsh reality. Amazingly, Harold was apparently still working up to the week that he passed away. To the world, Harold Price Fahringer was the consummate attorney, the lawyer's lawyer, a giant among men, the defender of freedom of speech, and as some have said, the Joe DiMaggio of the First Amendment. He was notably quoted as saying, "Freedom is only meaningful if it includes all speech, no matter who is offended by it. It would be a hazardous undertaking for anyone to start separating the permissible speech from the impermissible using the standard of offensiveness. The freedom guaranteed in the First Amendment is indivisible. The real issue is, are we afraid to be free?" His victories have shaped federal law and revised legal definitions. The impact of his life's work will continue to be recognized despite his absence. He embodied all of this to everyone else, but to us, you see, he was lovingly Uncle Buzz. Rest in peace, dear Uncle, for even now, we can imagine you holding high court in heaven and negotiating with St. Peter for the keys to heaven's gates. And now I would like to direct your attention to a short video montage we created.
Wasn't that great? I often would hear Harold make reference to his boxing days, and in looking at the picture there that we have on the front of the program, he must have been a pretty good boxer, because there ain't many boxers that wind up looking like Harold Fahringer, are there? My gosh. But he was very proud of that, and Debbie, thank you very much. That was just beautiful. We made reference before to Harold's two sisters, and Harold's nephew is the son of Peggy, and he resides now down in Maryland. He's the father of four children, and I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Tim Horton. Doctor?
On behalf of myself and my siblings, not all of which are here, one or two of us couldn't make it, I want to thank everybody who's here as part of Uncle Buzz's. I'll refer to him throughout this talk, or I might drop a Herald here and there. It's really an honor to be in front of so many people who were both friends, colleagues, in many cases both, and even adopted family. I'm going to offer three observations, and it's going to sound like I plagiarized those who went before me today. It's going to sound very familiar, but I could have written this in 1980. Everything I need to know about Uncle Buzz I knew in 1980 as a young man coming into my own, and what my parents had, my mother in particular, Peggy, had taught me about Uncle Buzz and what I'd already seen in my interactions with him. First, he was one of the hardest working men I ever met in my life. Part of that came from seven generations of Pennsylvania German farmers that preceded him. Just did a little bit of genealogy recently and learned that. Part of that came from just that unique spirit that he was inside. Just incredibly driven, wanted to work so hard and excel at everything that he undertook. That included his work in the courtroom. That included convincing children of all ages that a certain ace of spades had disappeared into an alternate universe. And that included his relationships with people. He always applied himself 100%, and that's just a repetition of what other people have said. Number two, he dedicated his talent and his work and his toil to the highest callings. And those were freedom of speech, freedom of the press, the right to a fair trial for anybody, regardless of what they're accused of. And those are the things that he really applied his work to. I'm a federal employee. The only oath that I take, and I take it very seriously, is to the Constitution of the U.S. That's something we're all required to do, and I was very honored to be able to do that when I went to work for the government. I don't know anybody in the government or outside the government who has done as much to defend the Constitution as he has. So what I've taken an oath to do, he actually did in his years of work, and like I said, his hard work. Finally, he was deeply faithful and loyal to the people that he loved. These included his beloved Margaret, first and foremost, who we knew as Aunt Midge, to his sisters, Peggy and Ann, my mother Debbie and David's mother, to his mother Pauline, and his father Harold Sr. And as these people passed away one by one, we got very rare glimpses into his private, personal loss there. But in every situation, and these are situations that in boxing analogy would have been body blows for me, he seemed to come back to his work and to his career and the things that he was driven to with renewed vigor and renewed strength. Since 2001, my wife, my children, and I have been very, very blessed to be able to see Uncle Buzz about once a year, not every year perfectly, but a lot of those years in between. And this last December, we were able to see him. Because of his health difficulties, we were afraid we wouldn't be able to, but because of Erica and Melissa, who we owe a real debt of gratitude, we were able to spend time with him. We met with him in his office, and he looked great. He was energetic, he was engaging. We're like, what's all this we hear about him not, about his health? He looked so good. And we had a great time talking. He talked about, as always, stories of his courtroom exploits and the various interesting stories that come out of that. We talked about some of his own history. I learned things I didn't know before about some of his boxing in college and how that all unfolded, and I'd love to share that with people if they want afterwards. And we talked about what was going on in my family with my children, and he was very interested in that, very engaged. Mark and Emily, our children, were there with us. And as we left, we were very optimistic that we would be able to see him again, maybe as early as summer, because of his schedule and ours. And as I was walking out the door, he said, Tim, you can close the door. I have some work I want to do. And I said, sure. And he said, stay in touch, Tim. And I said, I will, Uncle Buzz. And that was the last time I talked to him. But it was a great blessing to be able to have that time with him. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much, Tim. You know, there is an expression that says something to the effect that in life, find something that you love to do and you never work a day in your life. And there's, it seems to me, an awful lot of truth to that. It's not that Harold didn't work. He overworked every single day of his life, but he loved what he was doing so much that it was work, but it was a definition of work that is not the usual work. Ooh, I got work to do. He just loved it and threw himself into it so well. The next speaker is, much reference has been made to Harold's association in Buffalo with the firm Lipsick, Green, Fahringer, and so forth. And one of his partners is here, Paul Cambria. Paul has worked with Harold on many, many cases. He is actively involved, as Paul is now, in the First Amendment Lawyers Association, and he is joining us here from Buffalo. Paul, so nice to have you here.
All you tall guys. In 1971, I was a student in law school, and I was desirous of having a clerkship. I wanted to be a criminal defense lawyer. And as luck had it, my father and another individual had a mutual friend, and the mutual friend turned out to be, at that time, Associate Justice of the Court of Appeals in New York, Matthew Jason. And I met with Judge Jason, and he said, so you want to be a criminal defense lawyer? I said, yes. He said, well, if you can, you should try to get a clerkship with Harold Fahringer. You see, Harold has a wide range. Harold is a trial lawyer. Herald is an appellate lawyer. Herald is a constitutional lawyer. And I have to be careful with the power that I have being a justice in the Court of Appeals, but I'll do what I can to see if I can get you a clerkship there. Well, of course, like that, I was a clerk at Lipsitz Green, and I commuted from a little town called Fredonia, which is about 48 miles from Buffalo, and I was living there with my parents at the time. So I drive in 48 miles and drive home 48 miles, but I was always there in the morning around 7 a.m., and lo and behold, guess who else was there at 7 a.m.? So we were the only two in the office. At that time, there may have been about 30 lawyers and 60 or so support staff. So it didn't take Harold long to engage in a little conversation and start giving me assignments. And as the time went by, he must have been pleased with my work because they hired me, and I became his assistant, if you will, his associate. And there was nothing that you would not do for Harold. And the reason is because no one worked harder than Harold worked. No one was more dedicated in our office, in our community, to the law than Harold was. And so, you know, my wife could have been having triplets for the first time if Harold called to say, excuse me, dear, I have to go see Harold and do a research project, because it was that kind of situation. You admired the man so much. And as the years went by, I went from his associate to co-counsel with him in some of the very infamous cases, if you will, that he had. We tried the three Larry Flint cases together, including the last one when Larry was shot and they shot our local counsel. And here are Harold and I in the hospital with President Carter's sister kneeling and she's saying prayers, and Harold's looking at me and I'm looking at him like, this can't be real. And we spent many hundreds and hundreds of hours together in trials, in hotel rooms. I got to know Harold as well as anyone could know Harold. I must say he wasn't a bragger. He never told you about any of his accomplishments. They spoke for themselves. He didn't raise his voice. I never saw him have a temper tantrum or go into a tirade or spew out a bunch of foul language. It just didn't happen. Harold worked. There wasn't anything to chance. He made sure that it was done and it was done correctly and that the work was put in to make it perfect. He had an ethic that he impressed on you simply by being around him, and it was as follows. You were to research the law as much as was humanly possible till you got to a point where you were confident that you were correct. And then you were to go past that and see whether or not you could come up with a nuance or something that would be different, new, and provocative that would allow you to achieve the goal that you had to achieve for your client. And not only that, Harold was very particular about how he delivered his message as a lawyer. And I'm sure Erica can speak to this, but language was important. Harold would spend hours writing and rewriting to try to get the phrase so that it was provocative, so that it was interesting. He liked to express himself in a way that was memorable and different and stood out. And it served him well. In addition to that, as you know, we heard a couple of stories here about Harold. Harold had one friend he spoke of. I know he had many, but one he spoke of very often, a fellow named Stanley Malkin, who was a fellow in Florida, and he was probably one of Harold's closest friends. Obviously, his companion Margaret of all those years His passion was the theater, his passion was movies. He was a sports fan for sure. But it was all work with Herald. Herald had a hospital table in his suite at the Statler Hotel, which is where he lived when he was in Buffalo. That was across the street from our office. And it was one of those that you could pull over your bed with the flat surface on it, because he could put his work on there and watch a sporting event and at the same time work. There were times, there was never a guess as to who was in charge of any of our cases at any time. There's a lawyer in Denver named Arthur Schwartz, wonderful old guy, and Arthur and I and Harold were trying the Al Goldstein case in Kansas City, Kansas, the second trial, and Harold had decided that we should use charts in our summations, and he was really high on these charts, had some of the people in our office prepare them and so on, and Schwartz, when Harold wasn't present, would say, "I don't want to do this chart. This cockamamie chart." This was a quote from Schwartz. "I don't want, that's not me." I said, "Well, hey, you know, he's the boss. And, you know, we'll make it work." So we got to the summation, and Schwartz says to the jury, "Harold, you know, he wants me to do this chart. I have to tell you, it's really not me." And he goes into his own little summation. So now summations are over, we're in the car, and the three of us are riding back to the hotel. It's very quiet in the car. And when we get out of the car, Harold and I are in the back, and we're pulling the charts out, and Schwartz is there. And he says, he just turns to Art and says, "You know, Art, every ship has one captain." Schwartz is looking over, and he says, "Sometimes on the battlefield," because Harold was a buff of the Civil War and so on, he said, "sometimes on the battlefield, a commander makes a decision and 1,000 souls are lost, but the commander must make the decision." And he just walked away. And Schwartz says, "I think I've just been chastised." I said, "That's as good as it gets, Art. And you'll have to, you know, understand, Harold has a plan. Our cases were never to chance. In the morning, we used to have adjoining rooms when we'd go to these various trials, and I could hear him in the morning rehearsing his opening. Now, Harold could give an opening without any rehearsal. Harold was a wonderful orator, and he'd be in there rehearsing. And it was such an unbelievable inspiration for a young lawyer such as myself. And you know, all of you who knew him in the legal profession, he was someone who believed in lecturing and CLE and writing and so on. And he didn't do it to aggrandize himself. He had a philosophy. He wanted lawyers, young lawyers, to know the law correctly and appropriately. And he did it for that reason. He didn't do it to get his name around. Everyone knew Harold. He did it because he thought it was the right thing to do. When we started, people would file motions one at a time, cover on each and so on. Harold decided that we should devise an omnibus motion, and it would all be one package, and it would have an index, and we would have a brief, and the brief would have a cover, and the cover would have a title, and so on. And he, and that's the norm. And he's the one who set the pace for that. I will be eternally grateful for the fact that, as life had it, I was privileged enough to be associated with Harold for over 17 years and spent all of those hundreds of hours with him learning from him and hopefully adopting the work ethic that he had. He is clearly a giant. He has made the legal profession a much better profession for all of us. and we will truly miss him. I can hear that gentle voice, and I'll never forget it. You heard it here at the beginning, and it was always, well, Paul. And I found recently, I told Erica, I found recently a reel-to-reel tape. Herald used to do a radio show in Buffalo, and it was pretty corny. It was one of these Buzz and Bill shows, I guess. It'd be, hey, Buzz, hey, Bill, and then they'd tell some corny jokes. So one day I said to Herald, Herald, we cleaned out the warehouse, and I found this reel-to-reel tape of the Buzz and Bill show. And Herald said, you might want to destroy that. Herald, rest in peace, my friend.
Thank you very, very much, Paul. Well, for a little change of pace, I can tell you we are in for a very special treat. Much has been said on a couple of occasions here about the great love and devotion and support that Herald had for the theater, for Broadway, for music, and that whole part of being a New Yorker. And it is my pleasure to introduce a very, very talented singer who I know that you will enjoy greatly. And he's going to do two songs from Broadway, each of them having some particular significance to Harold. The first one is from the man from La Mancha. And as some of you may well know, the most beautiful song. And gosh, if it doesn't capture everything that we're saying about Harold, it is to dream the impossible dream. Did anyone's work in life reach for and embrace the impossible dream? And I know that one of the pieces of lyric there says, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And again, all just as Paul has said, that was what Harold was so much about. And the second song has significance. And by the way, the man of La Mancha, who was Richard Kiley, and Harold became friends in the course of Harold's great support and enthusiasm for the show. Very interesting side note. And the second song is got special significance because, and I would guess that many of you have seen, I gather, the longest running show in the history of Broadway, The Phantom of the Opera. And so we are going to be entertained by a person who was the Phantom of the Opera for 2 years. And in the course of that, and what's interesting about being in this building, I have been told, was designed after the Paris Opera House. So the tying together, which of course is a significant part in the theme and the narrative of the Phantom of the Opera. And the song that he will do is one that he's done thousands of times, and I know that you'll be thrilled by the very powerful performance of my very dear friend, Mr. Kieran Sheehan. Kieran?
To
when you go on Broadway, you better be able to sing, huh? And that was wonderful. Thank you, Karen. It's my special pleasure. Our talk has been about the Buffalo experience, Lipsick Green, and we are delighted to have the son. And actually, I was told that when Harold went to see The Man of La Mancha, he actually saw it with Bill's parents. And so that's kind of an interesting coincidence. But this is now the son of the original partner of one of Harold's in his Buffalo time. And I'm delighted he is here from Chicago, Dr. William Green. Doctor, welcome.
Hi, I'm Bill Green, and it's really an honor to be here. I want to first thank Erica and Melissa and other members of the firm's staff for not only putting this together, but also for all the support they've given to Herald over the last years. I mean, it's been incredible support. Herald was one of my father's best friends for almost 60 years. He joined my father's law firm in Buffalo, New York in the 1950s, when the firm was in its most early infancy. And basically, at that time, it consisted of my father, his brother-in-law, Dick Lipsitz, and Harold. And that's when the firm was simply known as Lipsitz, Green, and Fahringer. Unfortunately, my mom and dad cannot be here. But we're fortunate to have my wife, Grace, here, our three children, two of my sisters, their husbands, both lawyers, and several nieces and nephews. We're all here today to help us honor Harold's memory. Now, Harold was not related to me by blood or marriage. He was not my uncle, though that's my children call him uncle. To me, Harold was like a second father, almost as important and supportive as my own parents. I met Harold when I was 3 or 4 years old. I actually don't remember. Harold, from my mother's perspective, was the glamorous man who came to dinner virtually every Sunday, usually with Margaret Noyes, who we called Midge. Harold, from my father's perspective, was his most trusted, highly skilled law partner, who handled all of the criminal cases that came through the office while my dad handled the civil and employment cases. Now, Harold, from my perspective, was very different. At the young age when I met Harold, people fell into two categories. They were either children and playmates, or adults of authority, like my parents, teachers, and aunts and uncles. Harold was actually the only person that I knew who fell into both categories. On the one hand, he was clearly an adult. On the other hand, he was as much fun as any other kid I knew. In fact, he was more fun. He was a master storyteller. When we were small, the stories were about an invisible lion. As I grew older, the stories were replaced about stories of his youth and grew into long-standing conversations involving both of our lives. He was also, as been mentioned, a skilled amateur magician. He would perform at our birthday parties and was always ready to show us a new trick. One of the best things about Harold was his ability to transform the mundane into a fun event. Everything became a game with Harold. Examples: who could make the biggest cannonball splash or hold the breath the longest in my Uncle Dick's swimming pool? Even driving. Yes, Harold used to drive and enjoyed driving, I think, early on in his Cadillac around Buffalo, and the game with him became something called Can't Stop. The object of the game was to never stop the car, whether at red lights or any other time approaching another car. Of course, the highlight occurred at a red light when Harold refused to stop and actually hit my dad's car. My dad was not happy, but it was probably one of the best experiences I had up until that time. Saturday afternoons, we would go to the latest movies where we would be allowed to eat as much candy as we wanted until my father got involved, at which point we were limited to one item, from which my dad earned the nickname One Item Green. Harold loves, as many of you know, loves sports. He boxed in college, he golfed, he played football with us until he broke his hip one day during a particularly competitive game with the kids and the adults. Harold, though, was more than a great playmate to me. I knew Harold was a serious lawyer also. Harold and my dad worked every Saturday morning at their office at Lipsitz Green, and often Harold had me go to the library and find a book he needed or help him find a citation. Sometimes he practiced closing statements with my sisters, my mom, and I serving as jurors. My first time coming to New York was with Harold at the age of 12 or 13. Harold and I flew to New York, where Harold was trying a case, which I attended. It might even have been in a courtroom here. Unfortunately, Harold lost his wallet before getting into the cab, and only noticed the loss halfway from LaGuardia to Manhattan. And in order to pay the driver, we had to go to his client and good friend Stanley Malcolm, and he met Stanley at his place of business, which was an adult bookstore which specialized in adult literature. It was January. Harold could not leave me on the street, and so much to his embarrassment, the concern of Stanley Malcolm, I was let in and continued my education there. And it's in the bookstore where Harold borrowed money from Stanley to solve our problem. Harold, as you all know, loved musical theater and represented the management of the theater where the African-American version of Hello, Dolly was playing. We went to see this, and Harold took me backstage where we met one of the stars, Cab Calloway, who greeted us sitting down with two beautiful women, one on each knee. And it was quite an experience in New York. Harold continued to be a part of my life for the rest of my life. He encouraged me through college, and especially when we found ourselves both living in New York when I was a student at Cornell Medical School. During that time, Harold and I met regularly for dinner, often with Midge. Later, I met Grace, and Grace joined us for dinners starting in 1983. Still later, Harold came to our wedding in Buffalo and charmed everyone with magic tricks and began to develop a relationship with the next generations of Greens, Sassons, Ebbs, and Aarons, all the grandparents, grandchildren of my parents, Ruby and Carl, and Harold's honorary nieces and nephews. Harold would join us all for our many family vacations, events in Canada, New Hampshire, Vermont, Rhode Island, and Cape Cod. He was particularly important to the lives of our children, our triplets, Willa, Charlie, and Nathaniel. We hope perhaps the only negative was that he encouraged in them a distorted view of how people lived in Manhattan. Harold always had a limousine pick us up, take us to dinner, take us to a Broadway play, and then beyond that, treated the kids to great adventures and games similar to what my sisters and I enjoyed when we were kids in Buffalo. However, unlike Buffalo, where dinner might be at home, followed by a TV show, dinner in Manhattan was always at a fine restaurant, followed by front row seats at a sold-out Broadway show. Clearly, we are all richer for having Harold in our lives, and we are all terribly sad to see him go. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Dr. Green. Before? I've just been advised here by the boss that a slideshow is not to be enjoyed. That was great, wasn't that? I've just been advised all of those pictures are from the silent movie era, just in case you were wondering. Now we have the our next two speakers. Actually, I think we mentioned them early on. You have the trio of Erica and Nicole and Melissa. And Melissa is the first one to be speaking and is going to read a eulogy written by a very, very prominent defense attorney, Ben Brofman. Nicole?
I am going to read the eulogy for Mr. Brofman, but I just want to take a moment to say what a pleasure and honor it has been to work with Mr. Fahringer for the last 12 years. I didn't think I would be emotional since I stood up here, but he treated Erica, myself, and Melissa as family. Every Valentine's Day, he would provide his three angels, as he called us, with our box of chocolates. And as you can see from the photo, every birthday was celebrated, and he made sure that it was a party, as we would make fun of the office. There were only four of us, but we had lots of parties. But today I'm here, and I will read a eulogy from Benjamin Bratman, who is a dear friend of Mr. Fahringer, but unfortunately was not able to attend today because he's a Sabbath observer. But he asked that we please read this eulogy for him with words that come from deep within his heart. I should tell you at the outset that it took more than 2 years of Harold and I working together almost every day on two very long trials before Harold one day said to me, "Ben, my name is not Harold." Such was his kindness and his reluctance to embarrass me, because by then we had become such good friends. I remember saying to him, "Where I grew up, we had a lot of Harolds, but not a single Herald. And nobody ever heard of a Herald Price." Well, I never made the mistake again. He was always Herald after that, or HP, and he was always a friend, a good friend, wise friend, a refined man of class and humor, of knowledge, with great love and respect for the law. Harold was the only lawyer who looked as good at the end of a 16-hour day as he did when the day first began. White hair always in place, crisp white shirt always perfect, crisp blue tie to match his eyes, and always a disarming smile. Harold was a private man. All of us knew him as an extraordinary, consummate appellate lawyer, a very talented trial lawyer, a brilliant wordsmith. But how many of you also knew him to be an accomplished boxer and a stunningly capable magician? He was, however, above all else, a master orator, and perhaps the hardest working lawyer I have ever had the privilege of working with. I believe that I personally hold the record of being on trial with Harold longer than anyone else in his distinguished career. Together, we spent 6 months on trial before the Honorable Kevin Duffy in the Southern District, and then, if you can believe it, 17 months on trial before the late Honorable Vincent Broderick. During those back-to-back years on trial together, my wife was convinced that I was in love with Harold. Easy to do, because I spent all day with him in the courtroom and then all night on the phone with him as we charted the next day's cross-examination. Well, ladies and gentlemen, my wife was right. In certain respects, I did love Harold. I loved the way he prepared for trial, the briefs he wrote so effortlessly, his relentless work ethic, and the fact that every female juror over 40 seemed to swoon whenever Herald took to the podium. I think over the years, I may have been able to perhaps interest an occasional juror here and there. But despite trying desperately, I have never made any juror swoon. All HP had to do was stand up, and jurors smiled, listened, and the women really swooned. You learn a lot about someone when you are on trial with them for so many months. I learned, for example, that Herald never left the courtroom during lunch, eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich in his chair as he reviewed the notes for the afternoon's scheduled witnesses. Harold was the first person in the courtroom in the morning and the last one to leave at the day's end. Harold argued every objection like the case depended on it. And so many times, it was his extraordinary instincts during the trial that preserved the very appellate issue he would later successfully argue. Being on trial with Harold was like sharing a foxhole in combat. And in any form of combat, physical or legal, being with someone you can trust to always, always have your back is a privilege I enjoyed as his co-counsel for so many years in so many different courtrooms. Harold's was the quality of devotion that a client could not buy. And although he earned the nickname of High Price Fahringer for the huge fees he charged for his services, every client in every case believed that he or she got their money's worth because HP worked harder at his craft than anyone else. Harold was an unselfish mentor to me and to so many lawyers who owe a huge part of their personal success to the white-haired, consummate professional who was able to teach so many of us just by being himself, in his office, in a courtroom, or in any other setting where HP truly shined. Harold was a very private man, and as a consequence, even those who counted him as good friends did not fully appreciate the severity of his illness, nor the imminent approach of death that caught this friend totally off guard. So sadly, I did not get to say goodbye, and more importantly, I did not get to say thank you, nor ask for his forgiveness in the event I ever unintentionally slighted this refined gentleman who, when necessary, could be among the fiercest of advocates. So thank you, Harold. Forgive me, Harold, for not knowing how sick you were and how soon death would arrive. I hope you are at peace. You earned your place in heaven, where hopefully you are standing before God, defending the many up there who may well need your wise counsel. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Nicole. What beautiful words from Ben. I mentioned about this triumvirate here, and the third person is Melissa Keller, who has been with Harold for 8 years and is going to read a eulogy, one of Harold's clients and dear friend, Joey Testa.
I've had the privilege to work for Mr. Fahringer for the past 8 years, and also have had the privilege to wear one of his famous neckties today. As we all know, he was a man who prided himself on his dapper appearance. Today I'll read a eulogy from a letter from one of our most beloved clients, Joey Testa, who unfortunately is not able to be here today. However, his wife and his two beautiful daughters have flown in from Nevada and are here with us today. These are Joey's words. It is with a heavy heart and a sense of profound loss that I send this eulogy for my attorney and friend, Harold Price Fahringer. I have now lost someone who is so special that mere words cannot express my sadness. I've known Herald for over a third of a century, and during that time, he wasn't just my attorney, he became one of my dearest and closest friends. I wasn't somebody that just needed his professional legal representation, but someone who was very special to him, and it showed in every way. His caring and concern started with me 30 years ago, and it never stopped. It showed in every visit, in every phone call, and in every letter. Over years, we have laughed together and we have cried together. He was with me for the birth of my children, their lives and activities, through my incarceration, through my cancer treatment, through my financial troubles, and through every pain that life took through us. Herald was always there for me and my family. We shared sadness together as well as joy because we shared life together and we found humor that kept us both going. We could talk at length about the exact techniques for making a fabulous peanut butter and jelly sandwich or the art of eating Oreo cookies and milk. We had the same taste in movies, mainly Westerns, and his favorite was Shane. He also loved magic tricks. Coins and cards were his specialty. I remember during my first trial, whenever he had the opportunity to present it himself, Herald would entertain us with coin tricks. He even taught us one of his best. I've used this trick to entertain my children over the past during the visitations. This was Herald. He not only touched my life, but the lives of my wife and kids as well. He was a guardian for each of us in protecting our rights, including those rights guaranteed by the First Amendment. Many an article has discussed his love for the law. With Herald, it wasn't an occupation, it was his every being. It was his lifeblood of existence. He protected, he righted those that had been wronged, and he defended vigorously. No and can't didn't exist in his vocabulary, and I was very blessed to have him in my life. He carried himself with confidence and strength. Being with Herald was like being in the presence of an aristocrat. To me, he was royalty. However, at all times, he was always a humble and caring man who was true to his roots. I remember a time when I attended a funeral that Herald was also attending. While paying my respects, I was summoned to an office. Herald saw this and rose from his seat to seek me out and ask if everything was okay. I assured him I thought it was and headed to the office. I left the office a few minutes later and there was Herald. It wasn't until 20 years later that I brought it up to him and told him what his concern meant to me, and he responded in his always very modest tone. He was more than my counsel. He was a father, brother, and dearest friend, all mashed in one. Coming from Williamsport, Pennsylvania, in the background of that community's baseball legacy, Herald once wrote me a magnificent letter, which I will cherish forever, using the metaphor of that summertime game. In that letter, he told me, "When you called today, truthfully, I was somewhat down. But talking with you gave me a sense of exhilaration that I desperately needed to get through the day. It was like I'm out there on the pitcher's mound and trying to throw strikes, but nothing is working. I can't seem to catch a corner." And then suddenly the manager, Joey Testa, comes out to the mound and settles me down. "You're trying too hard, Herald. Just keep those pitches low and inside and everything's going to be all right. That's the effect you have on me, Joey. Thanks for giving me that lift." He always made me feel loved and cared for when we talked, and here he was writing to me explain how I helped him. The man was a true legendary champion and a model of perfection. He was a classy gentleman and the ultimate legal scholar. However, most importantly, he was a true friend to me and my family, and I will always treasure the love and support that he gave us through the years. So, in closing, let me paraphrase remarks made about one of the baseball's legendary greats. let me say this about Harold Christ Fahringer. Here stood the law's perfect warrior. Here stood the law's perfect knight. Here stood a true man's man. We love you, Harold, Joey Testa, and family.
Well, as we said at the outset, what a remarkable, extraordinary life, what a remarkable person, what remarkable accomplishments, and the composition of all of the speakers thus far have certainly borne that out, the different dimensions that everyone feels, and yet I'm sure we all have that sense of having been touched by Harold in the way that all have expressed. Our next speaker is been a very good friend of Harold's, is a defense attorney, handled a number of cases with Harold, and I'm delighted to introduce Mr. Tom Liotti. Tom?
May it please the court, my name is Harold Price Fahringer. Stop. Those magical words caught the eyes and ears of all hearing them, because soon thereafter you would then hear or see, reversed and remanded, dismissed, not guilty, sustained and granted. They were the words he sought, lived by, and heard more than any of us. His most important client was the Bill of Rights. Like Michael Jordan, we may say he was the best there ever was and the best there ever will be. If you ask lawyers or judges in the know who the really great ones among us were, you will hear Clarence Darrow and Harold Price Fahringer in the same breath, each with a different style, but Harold was in a class by himself. Trained as a boxer in front of juries and appellate courts, he would float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. Like those Southern lawyers who poor mouth you to death with the self-effacing talk, Harold would gracefully pull out eye teeth without the patient even feeling it. There were many things that caused him to stand out. I know because his former barber from the Waldorf Astoria was one of my clients. He told me how Harold would routinely come in and have his distinguished looking white mane treated with imported olive oil. He was the first in many things, but the first life member of the New York State Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, and the recipient of its Marshall Award, created by the late, great Jack Litman, who I assure you would not allow that award to be given to just anyone. He also received the New York State Bar Association's Criminal Justice Section Outstanding Practitioner Award. Adding to his special larger-than-life aura were the armor that he wore, which lulled his opponents into a state of confusion as to whether he was from a white shoe, Park Avenue firm, or from the belly of the beast at 100 Center Street. Paul Stewart navy blue suits, starched white shirts, plain off-white, yellow, or silver ties, spit-shine shoes, a velvet collar on his overcoat, a white silk scarf, and always chauffeured to and from court were his style. One famous lawyer admired his gold-bound legal pads with his name on them so much that he ordered some for himself. Sure enough, they arrived with Harold's name on them. His Hollywood stage presence, together with his unique eloquence, caused all to sit up and listen. One of his stock metaphors was taken from Alice in Wonderland and the Red Queen, who he compared to a government's rush to judgment. He wrote, "First off with their heads, and then the trial." If you wanted a good time, you were better off asking a New York taxi driver than Herald, whose idea of fun was giving a good CLE. In 1978, I attended my first CLE. The speakers were Paul Cambria, John Condon, F. Lee Bailey, and Harold Price Fahringer. I pirated Harold's materials and Omnibus Motion, which I used for at least 10 years with success, but for which I felt I owed Harold a portion of my retainers. With Harold, it was never about money. It was always about the excitement of the law. The majesty of the law was embodied in Herald. One Saturday at 11 p.m., Herald called. He was 24/7 in all things, totally devoted to the law. He had no vices. On the other hand, on the other end of the phone, I heard, "I think I've got it. The smoking gun." He often used a magnifying glass to review discovery. He found a single document among exculpatory discovery belatedly provided by the government on the eve of trial where the client had been convicted. We won a reversal in the circuit. Another important thing about Harold was that he never knocked another lawyer or judges. If you were the trial lawyer or referred the matter to him, your name would appear on the brief. There are countless cases where writs and leave applications were granted, in part for no other reason than Harold's name appeared on the paper. It was instant bulletproof credibility. Judges, too, were enjoying a piece of the legend and participating in history themselves by having Harold argue before them. He was fueled by his love of the law and his camaraderie with his fellow professionals, who love it as he did, with gusto, performing occasional miracles, saving lives, and making history by changing the law for the better. A few years ago, I, with two co-authors, published a book about DNA. It was, without a doubt, one of the most boring books ever written, except for the account in the book of DNA from the blue dress worn by Monica Lewinsky. Nonetheless, Harold, in writing a review of the book for the New York Law Journal, expressed its redeeming qualities. He wrote, "In the early days of World War II, American cryptographers believed they had cracked the daunting Japanese code. However, to be certain, they arranged to have an urgent message sent from Midway Island, indicating that their freshwater supply was almost exhausted. As anticipated, the communication was intercepted by the Japanese. Imagine the American's exhilaration, her cool blue eyes slowly sweeping the defense, suddenly barked out an audible, 'Blue right 24, sending Nicole wide left, and then on a long count, Fahringer drifted far right, setting up the play. Then on the snap, Liotti barreled head down, right up the middle, crashing through the center of respondents' line. Judge Krausman's arms shot high in the air, and it was all over. The stay was theirs, Mr. Inside and Mr. Outside, with the veteran signal calling of Dubno, had done it again. But of course, this was only the first game of a long season. Other games would have to be played to maintain the stay. But this game would prove to be a pivotal game, won by the pivotal play, by the pivotal players. Harold was a pivotal player in everything he did. If we had a Hall of Fame for lawyers and judges, he would have to be one of the first inducted. While we cannot stay his passing, we can fondly remember all that he gave to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. That was wonderful. It was clear from, I think there were two pictures, and I don't think it's the only two times that Harold read Screw Magazine, but there were two pictures in here. And so now I have the pleasure of introducing a writer and a former editor-in-chief of Al Goldstein's Screw Magazine. So we're in for a treat here. Mike Edison. Mike?
And very, very, very humbled to be here today. Harold Price Fahringer had always loomed very large in my imagination. What self-respecting journalist wouldn't want to find themselves as the defendant in a First Amendment case? Among other things, I was a writer for Hustler magazine, and for a while, the editor of Screw magazine, and Mr. Fahringer was one of the guys who kept Larry Flint and my friend Al Goldstein out of jail. This was a guy who charmed a federal judge in Kansas City into siding with a Jewish smut peddler. That he personally found pornography highly disagreeable only made him more perfect in his role as its defender. To so many of us on the wrong side of the moral majority, Mr. Fahringer was a giant. Jimmy Stewart might have played him in a movie if he were about 8 feet taller. As it was, they got John Cusack to play a composite of Mr. Fahringer and Larry Flint's other lawyers in The People versus Larry Flint, but it was like getting Fred Flintstone to play Abraham Lincoln. Freedom is only meaningful if it includes all speech, no matter who was offended by it, Mr. Fahringer once told a jury. The freedom guaranteed in the First Amendment is indivisible. You can't take it away from Larry Flint and keep it for yourself. A few years ago, I wrote a book called Dirty, 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 and it's a sprawling history of sex on the newsstand, and by extension, a limited but somewhat racy history of free speech. And when I began writing it, Mr. Fahringer was on the very short list of people I wanted to interview right away. And I called in his office, and I left a message, and he got right back to me without hesitation and very generously invited me up to his office and surrendered his afternoon to me and my tawdry book. He was dazzling, as was his legend, and not only in the magnificent storytelling and his entirely awesome suit, but in his radiant and lawyerly gravitas. I gave him the nickname the Joe DiMaggio of the First Amendment, but he was far too humble to accept it. Despite his sartorial flash, there was an earthiness about Mr. Fahringer. I guess dealing with Flint and Goldstein, you have to have a sense of humor. But you also need patience and an open mind and a willingness to associate with the riffraff for the greater good. After my book came out, I invited Mr. Fahringer to be part of an event I used to host. It was called the Banned Book Party, and it celebrated America's history of freedom of the press and the authors and artists and publishers that helped perpetrate and defend it. Mr. Fahringer riveted the crowd, and this was the kind of gently jaded and naively optimistic literati that come to shindigs at hip Soho bookstores, and he mesmerized them with the story of taking a New York jury to an X-rated movie on the Bowery to see for themselves exactly what had the local gendarme so upset. Well, actually, it was more of an art film. Does anybody even remember I Am Curious Yellow? But those were the days when you could be shut down for a little bit of boob. And he won the case for his client, the theater owner, and the hipsters in Soho swooned. More recently, we were in a movie together, a documentary about Hustler magazine, and boy, oh boy, did he elevate everyone else in that picture, largely well-meaning but ultimately greasy pornographers. Just being near him, virtually scattered electronically across the ones and zeros of a digitally recorded documentary, made everyone involved look legit. Gay Talese told me when I was writing my book that we got freedom thanks to the pornographers. We need a free society, and freedom is not won by literary tea parties and well-meaning virtuoso academies. It is won by disreputable people like Al Goldstein. And it's true, but what he left out is we needed people beyond reproach to defend them. Mr. Fahringer was not only repelled by the pornography he was fighting for, he looked like he hated it. He was the real deal, a clean living version of Elmer Gantry, which helped propel him as the go-to guy to defend men whose reputation hovered at sewer level. This was the same kind of tack that took a virulent commie hater like Richard Nixon to cut a deal with China. Jimmy Breslin once told me that there are four men we owe for our freedom of speech: Al Goldstein, Larry Flint, Ralph Ginsberg, and Lenny Bruce. What he forgot to mention is that half of them had Mr. Fahringer at their side. In the legal department, the other two didn't fare so well. The last time I saw Mr. Fahringer was about a year ago. It was at a ramshackle memorial for his favorite client, Al Goldstein, who had died about 6 months before. And he was still talking about the banned book party. Short of arguing in front of the Supreme Court, that was his idea of a good time. He was in a wheelchair, but he gave me a big thumbs up when I took a selfie, and he said, "Hey, Mike, when are we gonna do another gig?" Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike. That was very entertaining. Our next speaker is the CEO of Lawline, something we're all in the legal profession very familiar with, and a leading CLE, meaning that's the continuing legal education program that we're all involved with, David Schnurman. David, welcome.
I'm also humbled to be here. The history with Harold Fahringer actually goes back 45 years. My dad, while he was in law school, was walking through the courthouse, and he walked into a courtroom, and he saw the most passionate, most handsome person speaking, defending a police officer. And he was so inspired by him in law school, he said, "That's the attorney I want to be." Fast forward a couple of years, he was, of course, teaching a CLE program for the Bar Association, and my dad was there. He spoke with him afterwards and told him about the story when he saw him a couple years back, and they started a relationship. Years later, we started the Lawline TV show, and he was a frequent guest on First Amendment and Supreme Court and many other issues. I was lucky enough in law school, I interned for Judge Shulman, and he actually, Harold was a co-counsel on one of the cases that we were seeing, and he spoke so passionately on the First Amendment. And I can see, just by hearing all these stories, I didn't understand how lucky I was to see that in my two-month internship. When I took over Lawline, I started doing this in law school. He was, after I took the bar, of course, he was the first person I called to teach a CLE program. And I was lucky that he said yes. And I remember I went to his office. I had a $300 camera. Mike knows about that camera. It was what I got for my honeymoon. I didn't know what I was doing, but I knew he was the person I wanted to film for the first course. And I went there, and he had this book. I don't know if anyone's seen this book at trial with him. It had tabs, and each tab was organized, and it was so easy to turn. And I'm looking at this, and it's like a work of art. And I was so impressed, and then he started speaking, and I'm filming him. And his delivery, in terms of the way he spoke, and then the substance, I knew right away that it was going to have an impact on anyone who watched it. And of course, that was in 2007. And over the past 7 or 8 years, he's been back over a dozen times or more with Erica as well. He's had thousands of attorneys actually write comments, actually saying he's the best program that he has ever seen. He's had actually 40,000 attorneys or 40,000 courses completed on our site. And talk about an impact. I remember every time he would come by, I would thank him for coming. And he said, "Thank you for giving the forum," because he was so passionate about sharing his knowledge. In 2009, we were so humbled for him coming back so many times and sharing his knowledge. We gave him a Lifetime Achievement Award for teaching. And that was in 2009, and he's been back many times since. I wanna also say, it's not just about the attorneys who took the courses, it was the staff in our company. He was like a celebrity every time he came. We would talk about it days before, and then after he left, like, "Oh, did you see him? Did you get to talk to him?" And it was his work ethic and his charm that we were all taken by. The fact that somebody who's been an attorney for 40 years and somebody who just graduated college can have that same impact on them, I think that's telling. I wanna thank Erica for having us involved today. And I want to thank Micah. We're about to see a quick video. Micah has been with us for about 7 years, and he's filmed almost all the courses that Harold has done. And he spent extra time, nights and mornings, putting this together. And I just thanked him for his time. He said, "No, thank you. I've seen him all these years. I think when you first started, you already did a few courses. and this is the least that you can do, and he inspires all of us to do more. So with that said, if you could play the video, and I just want to thank everybody. And this is just some highlights of sort of the impact that he's made.
I have the awesome responsibility of representing Willie Jones in the most important moment of his life. As lawyers and prosecutors and judges, we all have a stake in our criminal justice system. We are all the caretakers of that system. And I believe all justices are concerned about, for instance, in the criminal field, of an innocent person being unjustly convicted. Whatever you do, and I mean anything in this field, you've got to rehearse it. If it's a reasonable doubt, you must adhere to it. You must not surrender it because of the lateness of the hour. These rights that a defendant has in a criminal case are a product of a civilization that, by respecting the rights of its least worthy citizen, raises the stature of all of us. If anyone can be convicted on this kind of evidence, no one is safe.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Dave. That was powerful, and that was Harold right there. We caught him beautifully. What passion, what a lesson for all of us. What a caring, remarkable person. I'm delighted now to introduce two people, the next and final two, that have had such a close relationship and impact on Harold. The first one has been his nurse and companion. She's provided great comfort for Harold, and before Harold with Margaret also, during their illnesses. And I guess dedication and love are the words that would best describe Nini Diallo. Nini?
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished friend and sympathizer of Ms. Herald Price Fahringer, this afternoon, we are all gathered and united in order to bid the last farewell to our beloved life partner, Herald Price Fahringer. I would like to take this opportunity to express my warm and sincere condolences to your family, friends, co-workers, and neighbors of Plaza 400, from the office to the doormans, the drivers to the Sherry Limousine Company, and everyone who take care of him. My condolences are extended to our partner, Erica Dobno, who treated you as her father, as well as your employees. 11 years ago, fate has decided for me to live under your roof by your side ever since. I come to your lovely home as a nurse aide, but because of your kindness and generosity, you turn me into a valued family member. I remember one day in 2005, you told Margaret, your lovely companion, your late lovely companion, in front of me, "Honey, Nene is from now on a member of our family." to which she replied, "Yes, of course." "I knew that you were sick, but I refused to accept or to believe for your eventual death. As if I definitely immortalize this extraordinary human being whose kindness, gratitude, respect, and sympathy are unequaled. I remember what you told me on Tuesday, January 7, 2015. Nene, I will not die. It's the angel that will take me to the sky. That day seemed an eternity to me because I could not sleep for a minute, thinking over and imagining my life without you. And I come to the conclusion, saying to myself, not possible, at least not now. Unfortunately, on February 12, 2015, I was caught by the reality. The Lord who had created you and given you to us took you back. Up until today, I can hardly accept that you are gone forever. For me, as you told me, you are in the sky with your angels. Today, as I can read the sadness on your faces, I realize, as from now on, Mr. Fahringer is only our predecessor. We will definitely join you someday. You have just responded to a call that each and every one of us will respond to someday. At the moment when you have returned to your last dwelling, I have come to say to you goodbye and share my farewell with these hundreds of men and women present here today. Now I understand why people with their loved ones where they pass away, simply because they were not able to tell them on time how important and significant they were for them. So, my dear friends who are present here, please let us not wait until it is too late to praise our loved one and let's show them our affection while they are alive. Mr. Fahringer, understand that as long as I will be alive, you are not dead. For me, since I will always keep you in my heart, I will never forget you. In order to honor you for your love of children, my sisters and I, we decide to give your name to our kindergarten, which is under construction in my home country, Guinea, that's West Africa, so that your name does not fall into oblivion. I cannot finish without thanking the brave doctors, that Dr. Martin Foyle, Dr. Shasha Daniel, Dr. Cohen Seth, and Dr. Gassani, and their staff who relentlessly and tirelessly took care of my boss during his illness. At the very end, when it was clear that it was nothing more the doctors could do, Mr. Fahringer asked us to take him home from the hospital. He kept repeating, home, home, while pointing at Erica and me, because he knew we were his home. When we arrived home, Mr. Fahringer was talking to himself. I asked him what he was doing. He told me he was rehearsing of the class that he was going to teach the next day. Even at the very end, Mr. Fahringer retained his wit, his charm, his intelligence, his kindness, his dedication for his work, and above all, his dignity. Goodbye, my dear boss. You can sleep in peace because you have fulfilled your mission on this earth. Send my regards to Margaret, your lovely companion who preceded you. I know with her, you'll never feel lonely. To both of you, may the earth be soft on you, and may the Lord accept you in his eternal paradise. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. For such a long time, I heard Harold make reference to the wonderful love, support, and devotion. And your words were beautiful, and thank you for that, as you've given to Harold for a long time. You know, one of the themes, it seems to me, that's been so dominant in running through today has been Harold's commitment to the law, his striving for excellence, and then once you reach excellence, let's do a bit more, as had been said by a number of speakers, which I think really captures the essence of what Harold's focus was throughout his life and his unbelievable four decades plus of legal accomplishments. And I say that only because in introducing Erica, Harold could have had and made a selection of virtually anyone would have been honored beyond words to have the education and the exposure and the experience that Harold could impart to anyone that was in his office. And so it seems to me that having made the selection of Erica and having been in his office and heard those famous words, Erica, many, many times, I congratulate her for her leadership. There are decisions that I suspect are rolling around amongst the triumphant that we heard from here today, the challenges of the future, the legacy of Harold, the legacy of the firm. But I can tell you I have great, great confidence that the right decisions will be made, the legacy will be kept, and today's event, as I said at the outset, was because of the vision and imagination and drive and coordination by Erica. We're very proud to be friends of yours, and congratulations for everything you've done. Erica, come on.
Thank you so much, John, and to Judge McKeon, and to everyone who came here today and made the time to speak, and also for all of you who came, and for the people who couldn't be here as well. Harold was, for 20 years, he was my partner, my coworker, my friend. When I had serious surgery 10 years ago, he had an argument in the Second Circuit, and he was absolutely crestfallen that I wouldn't be by his side for the argument. But what he did was he raced from the argument and raced right over to the hospital and sat with my mother by my bedside. Now, one thing Tom Liotti said that wasn't completely accurate was that Harold didn't have a sense of fun. And Harold really did have a sense of fun. We all know him as being a serious speaker and a, you know, blue suit, we've heard it all. But the truth was, he had more of a sense of fun than anyone. He would do things like play with the kids and just take it to a level that nobody could compare. Bill Green's triplets would come to New York once a year, and he would spend months planning what we were going to do to make every visit with them even better than the previous year. And so we would always be brainstorming, and I would make suggestions. So one year I suggested that we get a Nerf ping pong table. I had a little Nerf ping pong set, and I said, we can put this on your dining room table, and we could play Nerf ping pong. It would be great. Well, Harold couldn't really do that. He had to order an Olympic-sized ping pong table, have it delivered to his apartment. It's still there. And in addition, we had embroidered caps that said Green Family Ping Pong Champions made for them. And he had each kid decorate their own ping pong paddle, which I'll be giving to the Green triplets. And so he and the kids played ping pong, but he couldn't let the kids win, so he actually took lessons in ping pong. You didn't know this, but he took lessons in ping pong before you got there, and he practiced for days before you got there. He was a real prankster. In 1995, Al Goldstein, the publisher of Screw Magazine, unfortunately walked into 60 Center Street with a loaded gun in his pocket of his vest, which was unfortunate. And he did, in fact, get arrested, and he was charged with, you know, criminal possession of a loaded weapon. And Harold represented Al in front of the grand jury. You know, we spent weeks and days preparing Al for his grand jury presentation, and it was amazing, it was miraculous. He brought a loaded gun into a courthouse, and Harold got the charges dismissed. After the case, Harold decided to make a manual for Al on a guide to how to bring a loaded weapon into a courthouse. And, you know, we printed it up, and it was beautiful, and it had, you know, a nice cover, like Harold always did. Inside, it had one word of wisdom, which was don't. You know, he gave that to Al. He would do things like he would have the triplets or any of the kids, my nieces and nephews, he would take them to the plays, you know, greatest seats. And what he would do during intermission was he would pretend that the kid was a real celebrity. And he would go over to the kid publicly in front of people and say, oh, Maya Dubno, can I have your autograph? And she would sit there and take out a pen and sign a program, and other people would come over and say, who is that? And he would say, you don't know Maya Dubno? And they would ask her for her autograph. And, you know, I mean, it was just what Harold did. Harold was a fighter. He was a boxer. He was in the army. He fought for his clients. He was tireless. And when he became ill, he fought hard. He didn't want anyone to know, but he was one of the greatest fighters, and we were honored to have in our corner some of the greatest doctors around, and several of them, Dr. Foyer, Dr. Shasha, are here today. Dr. Cohen helped, Dr. Jasani. We were so honored for how well they treated him, and always in his corner, Nene. At all times, Nene was there, fiercely dedicated to him and making sure that he was okay. Our office family as well, Nicole and Melissa, we would have these luncheons. You know, he would look forward to it. He would come in and say, can we have a luncheon today? And I'd say, no, we have a brief due tomorrow. And he'd say, and then he'd come in the next day and he'd say, can we have a luncheon today? And I'd say, yes, it's okay, we can have a luncheon. And we would go and have these political conversations and debates. He supported all of us in whatever we were interested in, Nicole with her tennis, and Melissa followed in his footsteps and became a boxer. And so Harold, before she had a big bout, he ordered her a silk robe, boxing robe, and had Bama, her nickname, emblazoned on the back. And then even though he was using a wheelchair, he went to one of her bouts and led the crowd cheering, Bama, Bama. You know, here he was just so proud of all of us, and we were indeed his family. The reason why we're in this courthouse today is because he was very good friends with surrogate judge Eve Preminger, who unfortunately is ill and is unable to be here today. But we're here in part because he spoke in this very courthouse when Judge Preminger retired. And he spoke right here. And he spoke, there was a movie called The Bridge on the River Kwai, which was one of his all-time favorite films. And there was a scene in the movie, and actually the day before he passed away, when I went to visit him, he was watching the film. And it gave me a sense that he had an idea of what was going on with his medical condition. But there was a scene in the movie. It's about prisoners of war, and they're being held in a Japanese prisoner of war camp. And they work together. The British soldiers, the POWs, work with the Japanese, and they build a bridge over the River Kwai. And toward the end of the movie, there's a scene where the commandant of the camp is together with the captain from the British troops, who's played by Alec Guinness. And Herald has quoted it several times, including in this courtroom. And what he said is, looking out, Alec Guinness is looking over the bridge and the river, and the bridge that they built, and he said, "Suddenly you realize you're nearer the end than the beginning. You wonder, you ask yourself, what the sum total of your life represents. What difference your being there at any time made to anything, or if it made any difference to anyone." Well, I know that Harold Fahringer being here made a difference to me, and I know that it made a difference to all of you. But I think you also have to consider all of the people who watched all of those law line classes, those 40,000 people who watched those classes, the defendants in all of his cases, the people who read the transcripts of his cases, and realize that, you know, they can't be here, but all of the scholarship and the law that he did for all of these many years has affected them. And if all those people could be here today, if all of their voices could be heard, then ours would be just a whisper. In December of 1975, Larry Flint profiled Harold Fahringer in Hustler magazine. I'm sure his parents were very, very proud. I know my mother would be. She's here today. And at the end of the interview, Harold said, quote, "I think man's highest achievement is improving the welfare of his fellow man. I guess my highest hope is that when I leave this world, I can look back and feel that in some small way, I've left it a better place in which to live." Certainly, everyone would agree that he's left this world a better place. And I want to thank everyone for coming. We have photographs on the sides over there, and we have mementos from his life. There's a guest book over there if people want to sign it. But thank you all for coming.